Hello and welcome. I'm Biraj Swain and this is hashtag childhood matters on News Laundry. What are we discussing today? November 19th was the World Toilet Day and WaterAid, a global water sanitation charity, came with its global report called Out of Order, The State of World's Toilet 2017. In a classic he said, she said, the government came back with a rebuttal and WaterAid has gone on a mute mode, while Caravan did a cover story on the state of Swachh Bharat Abhiyan in May 2017, and they're standing by every single word of it. We're discussing sanitation, child health, WaterAid's reaction, Caravan's reaction, and how should researchers be standing by their stories. Before I bring in the panelists, I have a confession to make. In spite of my promise for no all-male panel, I'm breaking the promise, and there's a Cheshire cat grin on my face because two of my personal heroes have agreed to be part of this panel. So who do we have today? We've got Nitya Jacob, water sanitation expert, convener, coordinator of Sustainable Sanitation Alliance. Full disclosure, he used to head the WaterAid India policy portfolio 2 years ago. Welcome, Nitya.
Thanks.
Professor Partha, Mukhopadhyay, Senior Fellow, Center for Policy Research, Guru on Everything Urban, and after chairing the committee, Government of India's Committee on Migration, he's just poised to chair the Government of India's Committee on Sanitation and Counting Toilets. Welcome, Professor Mukhopadhyay.
Thank you.
And saving the last, best for the last, the man of the moment, Hartosh, Singh, political editor, Caravan magazine. They are still standing by their cover story. Welcome, Hartosh. So the WaterAid report said from 2000 to 2015, there has been an increase in the performance of coverage of sanitation, while in 2000, 1.2 billion people had no access to safe sanitation. As of 2015, it is 892 million. In India, they're saying 732 million people do not have access to safe sanitation. That's 72 crore in the era of the flagship program, Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, where all of us are paying 0.5% cess, Swachh Bharat cess on everything taxable. They're saying 67,500 child deaths happen every single year, which works out to 321 child deaths every single day because of lack of access to sanitation. 1/10 of maternal deaths happens because of sepsis, because of lack of sanitation. This is all data gleaned from the WHO, World Health Organization, and UNICEF joint monitoring program. Amongst the largest countries with maximum number of people without access to toilets, India tops the list. Then comes China, which actually has less than half of the Indian numbers. Then Nigeria, Ethiopia, and Bangladesh. They further disaggregated the Indian numbers, and they say about 355 million girls and women do not have access to safe sanitation. And the government obviously has just come out with a rebuttal in their press release, saying that these WHO and UNICEF numbers are not factoring in the great strides and achievements and in coverage which have been made since 2015. So we'll take stock. You've read the Government of India reaction to the WaterAid report. Mm-hmm. Any initial thoughts?
I think it's a classic response that if the facts which are quoted in a report, especially by a development partner which works closely with the government,
of WaterAid's credibility and standing,
appear to be inconvenient and inconsistent with what the government data says, then the government will come out with a rebuttal.
So this is predictable behavior?
It is predictable behavior. Okay. If you look at the MIS of the government, they claim a coverage of 72%. So the increase has been roughly about 40% since Swachh Bharat mission began. But that's a separate issue. I'm just looking at the data points.
WaterAid also says that amongst the 10 countries which have done maximum in the last few years, India is one of them for accelerating sanitation coverage. So Hartosh, your story, and this is one of the best stories. It's a must read. We'll be giving link to both the WaterAid report and the Caravan story in while we publish this program. It's called Down the Drain, How the Swachh Bharat Mission is Heading for Failure by Sagar. Sagar has gone to the belly of the beast. He's gone to Ahmedabad, he's gone to Gujarat, Maninagar constituency, Millet township. He's gone to the two villages adopted by Narendra Modi in Varanasi and Delhi. And the report pulls no punches at all. Why did you decide to do it? And why in the month of May? And what has been the reaction till now?
Well, first of all, I mean, for any such report, for any such work, I mean, the primary credit is the reporters. You know, we as editors or a magazine live in reflected glory. Yes. The work is done by the reporter and the work is substantive. I think, I mean, the reason we decided as a Caravan editorial team to look at a subject like this is simple. I mean, it is one of the government's flagship programs. It is one of the big promises of Narendra Modi. It is illustrative of how this government functions. And for us to analyze this is also in some larger sense a comment on what this government is about, what its promises are about. And in that sense, we undertook a comprehensive report. The reporter has traveled to different parts of the country, spent several months researching facts, figures, RTIs. He's done a tremendous job on it. And we put this out in public after our editors worked on it with the reporter. And so far, nothing has been challenged. And I think the report speaks for itself.
So for our viewers, some of the leading findings of that report is there is a latrine construction spree. Hardly any attention is given to the usage. Right now, the budget allocation is 224,000 crores. Out of which, and 13,000 crores has also been collected as part of CESS, Swachh Bharat CESS. The focus is on mass media campaign rather than behavior change. In urban areas, rehabilitation of sewerage lines, sewerage networks is almost non-existent. Inclusion is not prioritized, and even what World Bank has pointed that out. No mention of caste or manual scavenging. No mention of sanitation workers or their working conditions. There's an element of coercion to the coverage. There is no independent evaluation, which is why the sustainability of a lot of this open defecation-free declared cities from Indore to Gujarat is suspect now. And dengue and malaria have become a new reality for habitations which have got solid waste management plants, and these are most of the habitations are of marginalized populations also. And something which never gets talked about is that Government of India has entered a agreement with the World Bank of $1.5 billion, but the World Bank mandated that the conditional loan could only be given after independent evaluation. And since no independent evaluation has been made, we're actually paying a cost commitment of $3.75 million, whereas we are yet to get a penny. And independent evaluations as of now is the Swachh Sarvekshan that we keep seeing the advertisements on TV, but it's by the Quality Council of India, and its nature of independence is also under suspect. So Professor Mukhopadhyay, you've been part of World Bank, you've been part of Exim Bank. How does this cost commitment work, and what are your first impressions of Swachh Bharat? Your institution has also done a study.
Yes,
Yamini Ayer has done a study.
That's true.
And which is also referenced by the Caravan story.
Fundamentally, I think any program of this scale obviously will have a number of people looking at it. My colleagues looked at it. Hartosh has looked at it. You know, there's a variety of other people looking at it. As long as all these people, whoever's looking at it, are open about the methodology, how they ended up doing it, whatever they find, right? The government has its own tracking system. It presumably wants the program to succeed. And therefore, if it finds things at variance, I expect they would go back and see what's why the reason is there, maybe call these people and say, tell us your methodology and see how it works. Because fundamentally, I don't think it matters very much if the government tries to push a reality that is not there on the ground, right? Because the actual reality is going to be quite evident to people. So this is not one of those cases where you would actually end up being able to spin a story if whether or not a place is open defecation free, whether or not open defecation is happening, is something that those people in those areas and maybe around would know fairly well. So if they hear from the media that there is open defecation free and then you know for a fact that it is not, it actually would strain the credibility of government. So I don't think it is in the government's interest to try and push a narrative that is at strong variance with reality. And therefore, any such studies that come in with results that perhaps are not as appreciative of the government's efforts need to be taken for what they are, which is basically feedback that needs to be taken into account and needs to go back and check whether that is actually valid or there was something else they're putting together in place. As far as the loan commitment fees, etc., are concerned, I mean, it's standard practice with most loans, because fundamentally what the financial institution, whether it's the World Bank or whether it's any other bank, is doing is basically setting aside some money for you. Now it's expecting you to borrow that money and therefore pay interest on the loan. That's how it makes its return. Now if you haven't drawn down that money, there is something called a commitment fee, which basically means that it's a cost of setting aside that money for you. And that's, so I don't think there's anything particularly insidious or different about this payment that you're making, even though you haven't drawn down the money, because it essentially means that
there's a transaction operational cost to that money.
There's a structure, and you'll be able to pull that money down as and when it's as and when you meet the conditions, which one of the conditions, apparently, as you said, is a particular survey has to be done.
Independent evaluation, third-party evaluation. So since you talked about the ODF criteria, the open defecation-free criteria, the Caravan, your reporter went to actually Millatnagar in Maninagar constituency, which has elected Modi three times. And this it gives you goose flesh, the kind of shit, human feces, untreated feces, sludge, the living and working conditions of people over there, and also the living and working conditions of the workers of Ahmedabad municipality over there was there. Can you tell us what is the kind of time your reporter spent over there, and how has this your cover story been picked up by other sanitation activists and advocates? I mean, the reaction did not always be from the government. It could also be from the sanitation advocates, the plethora of players, sector players who are there.
So, I mean, days and weeks is what our reportage is, and if longer, yes. But in this case, it was small constituency days would do, but he spent a lot of time there. I mean, one of the unfortunate things that happens is, yes, while people in policy circles have realized the merit of the story, it has been picked up. It is illustrative of how media reports this country. Yes. The media will not touch a story like this. Swachh, that is why I do disagree that the government spin tends to get out of hand, especially for the middle class that is consuming this news. It actually starts believing what the government is spinning. And much of the media is not interested in examining this. They will take government figures, cite them. This is what the middle class consumes. It becomes a recurrent motive for saying Modi is doing great work. And a report like this, which has everything there, even then you will find that the media itself does not engage with it. So part of the problem in this
but
country...
But is there a bit of jealousy and competition also?
No, I don't think so. It is simply the nature of what mass media in this country is. It is urbanized. It is already largely reaching out to segments which don't need latrines. So this is about actually ignoring real problems, because these are inessential to their consumer. Or to the advertiser, and that is what is paying for the media. So for media, much of this problem just disappears. It is that Modi has good intentions. He's cleaning up India. He's doing building up these numbers, and this is what he's done. How are you challenging or questioning it? The media goes along with this narrative. That is the reality that's constructed for us, and that is where we are at the moment. As you said, there has been no independent survey. We should count these things as the equivalent of an independent survey. And what they end up showing is that there are huge problems which the government is refusing to address. without engaging with it or dismissing. Either they will not engage with what we have reported, or they will dismiss other reports which come from think tanks and try and suppress them.
So their report talks about the spending mechanism and how so much of it is on the visibility, event, spectacle and symbolism of standing with a broom and taking selfies rather than actual action. And the CAG report, the Comptroller and Auditor General report in 2009, evaluating the previous program, Nirmal Bharat Yojana, had also said the same thing, that too much is being spent on mass media and the visibility rather than on IEC behavior change and all of that. The other thing that report says, which I think is something Professor Mukhopadhyay should definitely weigh in, is that the importance of, since we're talking about smart cities, sewer lines, network, that's something pretty much low down the priority. New construction seems to be the mantra around it. You have actually spent a lot of your time looking at spending patterns. And is there anything particular that you are concerned about, or you think which is celebratory about the way spending is happening right now? Or the transparency, one of the things that their report is talking about, the transparency or lack of it in terms of tracking money and how it is being spent, especially the money collected from your and my everybody's cess, how that is being spent. Yeah.
So, okay, let's take
spending
a step
pattern,
back.
Yeah.
I think I'll also comment on what Professor Mukhopadhyay said about reports. Yeah. We've had the sanitation program, total sanitation program, then we had Nirmal Bharat, now we've got Swachh Bharat. There have been reports done by independent agencies on each of these.
Right.
And none of them has been flattering. So there were reports done in 2007, there's been one in 2009, and at regular intervals. But the difference was that the government took those reports on board. These were all government commission reports. The government took the reports on board and made policy and program changes at that time to reflect in their thing. So instead of being confrontational, it would make more sense to analyze why there is this discrepancy between the narrative that the ministry is doing and why WaterAid's report says what it's saying, or why Caravan's report is saying what it's saying. Now, regarding the funding, the lack of transparency on where the money is going, there is no understanding, or there's very limited understanding on what's happening to the cess money. On the Swachh Bharat Kosh, if you look hard enough, which is difficult on a government website, you can track the spending. At least you can track where the grants have been given. You can also sort of track where the subsidy payments from the budgetary allocations are going to an extent. That said, it's kind of difficult to understand the process by which the government, state government or a district government, actually raises a demand and the time taken for the money to come back to the grassroots. And the entire payment process, so while it has been digitized, so it goes directly to the beneficiary account and theoretically cuts out middlemen, it's still as cumbersome and bureaucratic as it used to be. So it's not just a question of where the cess money is going, or where the Swachh Bharat Kosh money, or where the budget money is going. It's also the efficiency with which this actually gets down to the beneficiary. Because 12,000 rupees is a substantial sum for a rural household in India, in most cases. Now, the entire process of releasing the money, first the entire process of applying for a toilet, getting it made, and then proving you've made it, and then getting the money, continues to be tied up in as many layers of red tape as it ever was.
I think, you know what...
Before you respond, the other thing, because since you are guru of everything urban, do you see any focus on sewer lines, especially considering in the last 91 days, 51 manual sewerage workers, cleaners have died in sewer lines? Do you see any focus on either upgrading them, constructing new ones, technology and safety, plus sewer lines also in Swachh Bharat Urban and Smart City? Yeah.
Two kinds of things. One,
and plus spending. Do talk about spending.
One of the issues is, this is actually an issue in terms of how this program is being rolled out, right? Because you are asking, it's supposed to be an incentive, it is not supposed to be payment for your toilet. That's the way it's constructed. And consequently, you have to first spend and then claim. Now, as Nitya said, 12,000 rupees even if it's 12,000, actually the spending might usually more, is actually quite a lot of money. Mm. And therefore raising that kind of money to be able to spend on it is an issue. And that has led to a variety of ways in which toilets are getting contracted, right? Because it could be happening through contractors, it could be happening through the panchayat working through something else. Because there really wasn't much thinking behind how will the household actually garner the resources to be able to spend this kind of stuff on the money in this time frame. I mean, eventually, one of the reasons I am among those who actually feel that the mass media story is perhaps something that needs, whether the kind of imagery is important is a different issue, but I think there needs to be, if you're looking at behavior change, there needs to be a lot more of communication in mass media, right? But if you look at, for example, the Swachh Bharat website, the thing that hits you is that they're counting the number of toilets. Is there a toilet counter on the story? So in some senses, there are different messages coming out of the government. At one level, they're saying it is not about construction, it's not about, you know, paying you, and therefore, and another level, it's saying it's about incentives and structures and so on and so forth. But when they're focusing on the stuff, they're still sort of counting the number of toilets. So it's so in that sense, there seems to be they're speaking in many voices, and that can be sometimes confusing. With respect to urban areas, and in fact, with respect to rural areas, the second other problem that sort of comes up with toilets is the fact that the current model that is being popularized and pushed is the twin pit model.
Yes.
Right. One of the reasons for doing that, actually, apart from everything else, is fundamentally that the twin pit model means that the waste is handled at the household level itself.
Right.
There needs to be no further public intervention or action, which would have been, let's say, if you had done a septic tank, there would have been somebody would have to think of some way of
cleaning
the tank and taking the fecal sludge somewhere and doing something with it, right? however, people are not really sticking to that particular model. They will build what they want to build. And a number of places, and this was the case even before, and this was the case even before you had the Swachh Bharat mission. People were building septic tanks or container pits of varieties of other structures. And this is the same is true also both in rural areas as well as in urban areas, especially in newer areas where people are building stuff. These need public interventions. So sewer lines is one thing, and a relatively small number of our households are actually connected to sewer lines. A much larger share of our households essentially have septic tanks. And for both of them, on the sewer lines, we do not have, there was legislation passed, the 2013 Manual Scavenging Act, a Prevention of Animal Scavenging Act, which laid down detailed guidelines about what kind of safety procedures would be needed where you to send people to clean it. None of that stuff is actually followed. So that's a big problem. That's on the sewer side. And on the septic tank side, there really is very little attention being paid to infrastructure in order to, you need vouchers to be able to clean it, whether you're doing it through the private sector or the public sector, you'll need places for this sludge to be treated. So that kind of supporting infrastructure, that is, if you suddenly see this huge upsurge in toilets, you'd also need supporting infrastructure to treat it, right? As long as you're doing open defecation, the field of sunlight was supposed to take care of all of that stuff, etc. Now you need something else. So it's these kinds of structures, and one understands it has to be sequential and structures and so on and so forth, but there is, in those respects, relatively limited communication, understanding, or whatever the stuff is happening about those associated things which would be really needed if you want to, if you focus on the real reason you wanted Swachh Bharat. The real reason you wanted Swachh Bharat was not because there was feces on the street and it looked bad. The real reason we wanted Swachh Bharat was because those practices had certain health consequences. And it's unless you do these associated things, the health benefits of even doing that kind of stuff would not be there, because you'll still have leachage into the water, which will then sort of lead to fecal coliform in water. You'll have variety of other things.
Actually, Professor Manoj Jha of the Delhi School of Social Work has gone on record both in their report and in Scroll's latest report also saying Swachh Bharat is the perfect program for the current government to take on because it gives you a lot of opportunity for symbolism and for homilies, for standing on the pulpit and giving homilies. The real reason of child health, health outcomes, or maternal child health, or overall health outcomes, is something that he thinks is suspect for because there has been constant slashing of the health allocation budgets and the nutrition allocation budget. So if health was the be-all and end-all for this government's concern, then you would not be slashing the diet budget. But that's for another day. Maybe Manoj Jha should come and talk about it. For our viewers, three things. WaterAid says in a previous report that 70% of the sewage is untreated in urban India, so a lot of the raw sewage and fecal sludge that Professor Mukhopadhyay is saying is a reality. Second is Caravan story talks about it has riveting narratives about these plight of sanitation workers in the portable toilets, even in Delhi, in posh areas like Pikaji Kama place. And the report has also gone to Akshardham metro station and checked out the living and working conditions of sanitation workers. The third thing is the government of India rebuttal to the latest WaterAid report actually says, now this is something I want both of you to react, says 28% is the uncovered percentage, not 56% as WaterAid says. Where is the reality between 56 of WaterAid and 28 of Government of India PIB release? Stick your neck out. Yeah, as no, expert who will be heading a committee to count toilets. I mean,
there's a working group that will be, that is looking at, it's not so much a committee, it's part of normal process. The National Sample Survey does.
Talking about National Sample Survey, so Caravan story says the National Sample Survey reports to the Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. Having read Hartosh's work, I presume the way
Sagar's work.
No, not this one. I'm talking about, I'm presuming CBI has been co-opted, CVC has been co-opted. We have seen establishment economists and statisticians coming out of woodwork and singing the government spin. So why does Sagar think NSSO is not independent enough? Sagar has made that point that because it is part of a ministry, it is not independent enough. Do you think that's a point to be made?
Well, I mean, this is evident in this country. Whoever pays your salary does decide how you end up working. And if the government is paying your salary, and especially this government is paying your salary, and you have a reporting structure where promotions, etc., are all based on government examination, you will do certain things. And while the subversion has never reached the level that we are talking about in CBI, because the political need for that still doesn't exist, that there will be some influences and biases is a certainty, I think, in this country.
But to be fair to the NSSO, for example, when they actually did a...
Are there safeguards? I think the point both of us are trying to ask is, are there safeguards?
The NSSO is one of the two things that happen. One is, of course, there's an institutional memory. And Hartosh is questioning whether we have enough institutional protection. That's one issue. The second is almost all NSS data eventually gets released at unit level records, which means other researchers have access to the data and we're able to look at it. So there is that kind of transparency that sort of works with the NSS. And third, to be fair to them, in the last survey they actually did was focused on this. They had a rapid assessment survey on Swachh Bharat, which was done in May, June 2015. And in that survey, from what I can see, the percentage of persons going for open defecation was 52%.
52?
Yes. That is what their survey...
This was May, June?
2015. You see, fundamentally, one must realize that what the government is claiming, and even in response to the WaterAid report, my understanding is that there has been a lot of change between 2015 and now. Mm-hmm. Right? There is fundamentally... Obviously,
so
people
are we
need to
closer
go out
to 28% of uncovered?
The two kinds of issues that look through. There
you
is a lot of
so complicated with.
There's a lot of toilets being constructed, uh-huh, according to them, right? So what they're doing is basically saying, I had so many toilets.
A lot of it vandalized and unusable, according to.
So all of that, those issues, and most importantly, forget the vandalization, unusable, all of that stuff, are people actually using it? If people are actually using it, it's quite possible that the number would have come down. After all, that number which was there The open defecation number, which I said about 52, was in the census of 2011 was about 67. So there has been rapid movement downwards if you look at those kinds of numbers. The second point that the NSS survey makes out is, if you have water, then you use the toilet. In fact, the numbers are actually very striking.
Access to water.
So it says percentage of households having access to water out of households having toilets. In urban, it's 99%, and in rural, it's 94%. Right. So fundamentally, while you might be focusing on building toilets, you need to, at the same time, trying to figure out how are you going to get water into those households. And so to that extent, it's these kinds of, unfortunately, in this particular case, the Ministry of Drinking Water and Sanitation is like one particular issue. There's obviously focusing largely on drinking water, not on other uses. But it's these kinds of associated things, whether it's treatment of the stuff or the provision of water, that would need to also be addressed if you're serious about doing this right. So as of now, unfortunately, it looks like most of the reaction is coming on the numbers of
toilet. Yes, numbers and coverage.
And that fetishism, I think, needs to be, even within the government, that in their own literature and communication, they seem to warn against such fetishism. And yet, when these kinds of things happen, they seem to push back so hard on it. So there's this sort of schizophrenia in the way they're reacting to this.
So Hartosh, actually that's a very good take-off point. Your story doesn't fetishize on numbers and coverage.
One of the most important things, and I want to stress this here about Sagar, in terms of behavior and the centrality of caste, and I think some points have been made, but I think what Sagar is also pointing out to, and I think this hasn't been examined enough, is that when he starts looking at the building of toilets itself, there is a caste discrimination in the building of toilets. What is happening is Dalit areas are not getting the number of toilets and the quality of toilets that OBC areas are. Now, if you look at it from the health point of view, Dalits are the ones which have the worst access to open defecation areas in the first place. In fact, if you were serious about health, it is starting at this level that you would need to build toilets and then move to OBC areas. Now, the sampling is also not taking note of caste in terms of how toilets are being built, while it is crucial to health impact and other questions. That's one thing that Sagar has very strongly noted, and I don't think this has become part of analysis yet. The second thing that he has pointed out is manual scavenging and the increase. I think the Coffees in their work, in their book, have also made this
Jen
point.
Yes, Jen Spears and Diane Coffey have written this book called Where India Goes, where they have said 2019 is a chimera. It's not going to happen. India is not going to be open defecation free as long as we do not address the issue of caste.
Is that one? Pit toilets, which have to be cleaned by families, never do get cleaned by Indian families. They need people to clean them, so they will not build those families, because at this moment you are not getting the kind of labor that you need. Everything that is happening in urban or rural areas, wherever the cleaning is happening through manual scavenging, no safeguards, no proper protection. You are not connecting to sewerage lines. Basically, you are only increasing the process of manual scavenging, however you may pretend otherwise. You are actually violating the law through the very process of Swachh Bharat, and that is clear in what is happening on the ground.
The other thing, Sagar has quoted Chandrabhan of Dalit Chamber of Commerce, who said the problem with symbolism about the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan is it started by the Prime Minister from a Dalit community, almost reinforcing as if the Dalits are unclean. And broom is a throwback anti-diluvian tool, not the clean and advanced technologies should have been used as part of symbolism, and it should not have started from Dalit. But I think there are debate about the importance of starting it from Dalit community, the whole campaign, rather than rice in a hill, or because Chandrabhan Prasad says that rice in a hill generates waste, it never treats them. So what was the point of starting it from there? Now let's go to the point for which I was really keen that Hartosh is part of this conversation and Professor Mukhopadhyay. Censorship, both government censorship and self-censorship. For our viewers, in the last 10 years, we have seen 4 really important cases of censorships which have not been called out by media either. And I think we can take a bit of pride because at least the UNICEF rapid survey of children, when for 14 months it was not published because Gujarat was doing worse than Bihar, I wrote the first article, News Laundry published it, and 5 weeks later, Economist magazine did a complete data dump of the UNICEF article. But it's not just this regime which is complicit. Before that, the World Bank Poverty and Social Exclusion Report did not publish the Muslim chapter. NFHS, National Family Health Survey, for 10 years it was not published. Another survey was not done after NFHS 3. The NFHS 4 took 10 years because when Shining India narrative was being built, malnutrition also increased by 10%. And in terms of self-censorship, in the last 2 months, we have seen Global Hunger Index of IFPRI, when it showed India's ranking at 100. They gave another press release saying that you cannot do year-on-year comparison, you cannot do country-on-country comparison. Then the question one needs to ask is, what is the point of an index in that place? WaterAid has gone in a complete mute mode. Full disclosure, we reached out to their India office, we reached out to their global office. India office was completely mute, global office was reticent. Whereas I was told that Professor Nagraj, when he deconstructed the National Crime Records Bureau data on farmer suicide, neither the pushback from the government was as fierce, nor Hindu or Madras Institute of Development Studies ever backed down on their researches. Why do you think that is happening? And it seems it is not just in this current government, it has always been like this. Why do you think that is happening? And why are the journalists also not seeing them as acts of censorship?
Well, clearly in this country, one, there is this paranoia about criticism. And when flagship programs are concerned, there is greater kickback. And criticism for international bodies is particularly galling for whatever reason, you know. And you will immediately get ministries reacting. You can see that it's not just in terms of access and working with the government. Every academic from outside this country who's working here knows that if they are seen as overtly critical in any way, they may find that visas do not get renewed.
It's a fact. I believe India doesn't give research visas.
So this is not overt censorship, it is there. And the last part of it is, I think, that ignoring what is out there in the public record, criticism, I think the WaterAid body, the WaterAid report has got pushback. The Caravan report will be ignored by the government. That also amounts more or less to the same thing. If the government is not taking in feedback from public, either clamping down on organizations that are critical or ignoring them and saying that this does not matter, then really their interest is not in running the program, but is at projecting the government, and since this is a personalized government, in projecting Modi in a certain way, basically. And that is at the heart of this problem. It has existed in the past. I think it has been aggravated under this administration.
Your institution put out an equally critical report on the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. I believe you have not retracted a single word of it. Your institution also has members who've been part of the government committee, including you. Of course, one of your colleagues has now become the chair of the Niti Aayog. So what should researchers do?
They should do research.
No, when the pushback happens. Is there a challenge between maintaining insider access and also doing inconvenient research?
That, I think, is a question for every individual researcher to ask.
How would you handle it?
We have always found that as long as there is obviously tension, there is obviously pushback, there is obviously people who say, well, how exactly do you find it? And that's what makes it incumbent upon us to make sure that when we put out something, we know exactly what it is about, right? So how exactly we need to know how exactly the sampling was done, what question was asked. For example, one of the big differences you mentioned, Diane and Dean's work. So for example, let's say when you're asking somebody whether or not there's open defecation, question from the Quality Council question, I think, says, has anyone in your household gone for open defecation recently? And the answer for that, especially since there's a large media campaign which sort of tends to say that open defecation is a bad, you might be tempted to say no. Right? On the other hand, their way of asking the question, which I think also was used by my colleagues and the researchers, was to first contextualize, some people do this, some people do that, what do you usually do? And then, in addition to that, my colleagues asked, where did you go today? Right? And there was a difference. So somebody might say, usually go to the toilet. Today I went in the open.
Norm aisa hai, par aaj main aisa kar raha hoon.
So the issue, therefore, is how you ask questions, therefore, matters, right? So both these numbers that are coming out may be absolutely accurate. That the government number is an answer to this one type of question. The other numbers are an answer to a different type of question. How you should ask questions is essentially something somebody should sit down and discuss and say, which is a better way of asking a question. There are ways of figuring that story out.
So you're saying, other than standing by your findings, being completely transparent about the methodology, about the questionnaire, the tools, and the methodology.
Because fundamentally, it is essentially, if it was two researchers finding different results, that's exactly what would happen. Yeah. Right? They would sit down and try to compare why is it that our results are different.
But under no circumstances you think going on a mute mode or backtracking is a good idea for researchers' credibility.
You might want to go for a mute mode for a while in order to sort of formulate your response and make sure, because you know, it's quite possible that the person who is currently put the stuff out is a report. We are small organizations. An organization like WaterAid is a large organization. They would have a whole backup as to exactly
CPR
how
is the most influential think tank right now. No, probably after India Foundation and ORF,
so
for obvious reasons.
For whatever reason, okay. So the fundamental reason is we when something comes through, the people who have done this survey are in-house. They've controlled it. They can respond quicker. Large organizations, maybe they need to go back and dig. But you know, it's not my place to say about why somebody is responding otherwise, but I can visualize scenarios why some time may be needed to formulate a response.
I think the Government of India press release is pretty smart. It actually has divided the WaterAid India from WaterAid Global, saying the India people have not been able to inform the global team about how good we are.
My personal reaction to that particular pushback was, I actually, when I read the WaterAid Global report, the out of order report, It seemed to recognize the, in fact, was I felt it was quite positive about the government's efforts.
Yes, congratulatory,
So, but you know, I mean, but people read different things into what they're reading.
Doesn't that go to Hartosh's point that you can't even take a nuanced criticism? Everything has to be blanket congratulations.
I mean, there wasn't being critical. It was just giving certain numbers and it was stating something, and whatever there was opinion, there was actually, as you said, this thing. So, you know, but on the other hand, you know, everybody reads things differently. There's a whole Rashomon story. You see different things in different ways. So, I mean, obviously somebody feels that there needs to be a statement to be made, and they have made it. My own sense is neither this should affect what organizations do. And hopefully this does not mean that these are I'm hoping that Hartosh is not right when he says that these are overt ways of actually trying to take people down, because if you are a reasonable research organization, there's no reason why you should be intimidated by something like that.
So we have to wrap this up. You had a research which never saw the light of day on the status of sanitation in the select states of India, right? And I do not think Rashomon is something we can afford in public funded programs which are embedded on something as fundamental as sanitation and paid for by taxpayers and are also on the cusp of caste discrimination and everything. So I think Rashomon is something we should actually be intolerant about.
The caste issue is something I think we have been dancing around. I mean,
There is no
I may have disagreements
open
with what Diane and Dean are saying in various ways, but it is definitely an issue given our culture and given our historical way we have handled this issue. It's something that we definitely need to be aware of, you know, and especially when you're looking at surveys in these areas, these are things that we need to be careful about. And we need to be careful about, for example, even in the sampling process to make sure that the kind of issues that Hartosh is saying, where particular hamlets have been left out and so on and so forth, which is what defines, what the reporter finds in a story. whether or not the surveys are designed to actually pick those kinds of things up. And they can be.
I don't think the surveys really are actually designed, because in the implementation, and it's supposed to be universal coverage, it always starts with the politically important villages or parts of a panchayat or of a town.
Right.
And then it may trickle down to the Adivasis or the Dalit areas.
But they also went to the politically important villages and completely untraveled.
Better off within, comparatively, even if they were, yeah.
Yeah, no, what exactly. I meant within a panchayat, if you have multiple villages, it's the one where the sarpanch comes from or the people who supported him, they get the benefits first, and maybe in subsequent years, the other villages will be covered.
So but there'll be a chronology.
There's always an inequity in a universal coverage kind of an approach, unless there's a conscious effort at the district level, which is where the whole planning and implementation happens, to reverse that.
So the leave no one behind slogan of sustainable development goals is still just a slogan, according to you.
It is. And I think
what Nitya is saying is leave no one behind by when?
Exactly. So if you're saying it's going to be a five-year program, you want to complete it by 2019, maybe by 2019 the Adivasis and Dalits will get the same level of access. But is that fair?
Do you want to give the headline message of the study that never saw the light of day that you led?
It was actually a far more critical study on SBM, but there's a writer there that it was only 1 year after SBM was started.
So
systems are actually getting in place. Yeah. Which kicked in, I think, about 2016. Mm-hmm. The entire thing of which philosophy to use, which approach to sanitation to use, how money is going to be transferred, how is it going to be monitored. And I think just from Professor Mukhopadhyay's thing on the monitoring, they shifted the goalpost from counting individual toilets to counting ODF communities.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's still counting, and it's counting the number of toilets, it's not counting usage.
Yeah.
And Diane Coffey's, Dean Spears, various other people have always said that usage has stayed about 30-40% of the coverage. So that's always going to be a challenge. You might reach 100% coverage, but you'll never reach 100% usage unless you focus on the whole communication, behavior change kind of.
Any last word on, quick addition.
A quick thing that, exactly what Nitya is talking about. The recent guidelines which have actually been issued do exactly that. They're actually talking about ODF++. They're doing a variety of things in that area where they're talking. So this is why I say that there's a schizophrenic approach.
So when you when your committee starts working, is there anything particularly different you will do in terms of counting?
I think it's too early to talk about that. And fundamentally, those things need to maintain relationships with prior surveys, because this is not the survey that the committee that I'm looking at, the working group that I'm looking at, is not about measuring Swachh Bharat. That the government is doing through its...
You look at household sanitation access.
There is, every 5 years, there has been this measurement of housing conditions, of sanitation, of disability, and drinking water, etc. And this is just one in that program. So there is, I don't think we should, at least I don't, link these two things at all.
Sagar has quoted that, and they said that the 2011 NSSO said about 70% of rural households do not have access, and then also two-thirds of, I think, households do not have access to potable water.
That was roughly, was precisely what the issue was. That with the previous campaign, the rural sanitation campaign, there was exactly this very large administrative data which showed that there was huge coverage. And then when the census came out in 2011, those numbers looked much smaller than what one would have expected, given the structure. So, which is what is making people a little skeptical about administrative data, but I wouldn't hold that against them. There's no reason that, because it was done this way, this would be done that way either. It's, I think, not fair to sort of extrapolate from what was done before to what was done now.
Hartosh, any last word on how media should be reporting these researches and surveys?
As I said, I think we've covered a lot of that in terms of what media should be doing and its own problems. What I think is, it is also necessary to emphasize how governments or this government should be receiving that criticism. See, there is an antagonism. I can understand if we are dealing with saffronization of education that the government thinks that we are at loggerheads with the media that is writing this. Yes. I, as one, do not want saffronization of education to happen. Swachh Bharat is different. I think we are all on the same side. Nobody is opposed to the fact that we need something like this happening. Mm-hmm. We all want it to succeed. The work we are doing is to point out, look, if you are doing this, it's not working Could we try something else? And in that, actually, we are partners. And on Swachh Bharat, the government has to understand that they should take us all on board, because I think we are on the same side of Swachh Bharat.
Couldn't say it better.
Yeah, I completely agree. I mean, we're all trying to improve the quality of life in towns and villages. So Swachh Bharat is an important way of doing it.
It's everybody's agenda.
It's everybody's agenda.
And negative feedback is still important feedback.
It's still feedback. And if it's based on sound evidence, granular sound evidence, then why not?
The PUCL Rajasthan, when they took on the government on the starvation deaths in the writ petition of PUCL Rajasthan versus Union of India, also says exactly the same thing. This is not an adversarial petition. We are all on the same side. It's important to smell the coffee, look at the starvation deaths happening in the grassroots, and start doing programs, PTAs, ICDAs, and see that they reach. That was our fifth offering on hashtag Childhood Matters series, Swachh Bharat and Childhood in India. We'll publish the video on News Laundry site and the YouTube channel. We'll also publish the links to the Caravan story and the WaterAid report. The Caravan story is called Down the Drain, How the Swachh Bharat Mission is Heading for Failure by Sagar. The WaterAid report is called Out of Order, The State of World's Toilets, 2017. Thank you for joining us. Big thank you to all our brilliant panelists. And a big shout out to Shubham Mishra, our producer, Anil, the sound recordist, and Raman Kirpal, our managing editor, for his guidance and inputs. Big shout out to the International Center for Journalists, Washington, D.C., for my fellowship, which is encouraging us to do this series. The next offering will be on caste and sanitation, and we hope to get Bejwada Wilson, so please don't miss that. Please support independent media, please support News Laundry, and Caravan also. We need that kind of journalism. So you can decide what really matters and why childhood matters. This is Biraj Swain signing off.